Thank you. congregation, please be seated. On behalf of the Irvine family, I want to welcome all of you to Carriduff Free Presbyterian Church at this time. We really appreciate you gathering together in such numbers. We apologize for the slight delay in commencing the funeral, and we appreciate your patience. For those who don't know, my name is David McLaughlin, and I'm the officiating minister here of the congregation, and it's my honor to be able to take the funeral service for Wesley Irvine. We're gathered together this afternoon in the presence of God to do three things. We remember God's sovereignty in death as in life. Job said, "The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Now, it is true that our hearts are sorrowful, our spirits are heavy, we're heartbroken because of Wesley's death. Yet with submissive and sorrowful hearts, we have to acknowledge the day thou gavest, Lord, has ended. The second reason we're gathered together here is to seek God's word of comfort for our hearts. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die." The prophet Isaiah was instructed to say that them that mourn in Zion, beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called the trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. We remember that it's written, shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. And he said, "Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." Now there's a third reason we're gathered together at this time, and it is this. We come into this meeting house to give thanks to the Lord for the life and testimony of the late Wesley Irvine. He was officially known as John Wesley Irvine. Wesley died peaceably in the hospital after a short illness on Thursday at 5:40 p.m. On behalf of Carriduff Free Presbyterian Church and the Kirk Session, the whole congregation, I know that they join with me in extending our deepest sympathy to the whole Irvine family in their hour of bereavement. Wesley was a beloved husband of Rita, a devoted father of Sharon, Kyle, Glenn, Julianne, Heather, and Caroline. He was father-in-law of David, Susan, Claire, Simon, and Andrew, a much-loved grandfather of Megan, Jonathan, Matilda, Timothy, Anya, and Ailsa, and a dear brother of Muriel, Stanley, Fred, Eileen, and the late Brian and Victor. He was sister-in-law to Tilly, who's with us today, and other members of Rita's family. You see, Wesley's death is a big blow to us all, a big blow especially to his immediate and extended family, but a big blow here to Carriduff FPC. He's a foundation member. Please be assured of our prayerful support at this painful time and in the days to come. On behalf of the Irvine family, I would also like to express our deepest appreciation to the staff of the Ulster Hospital, Ward 16, for the loving and careful way you looked after Wesley during his time there. We also want to thank the undertaker, Mr. Norman McBriar, and his team, Donna and Barry and Mark, for the tremendous way that you have helped the family in a very stressful situation. Your devotion, your professional, your attention to detail is very much appreciated. I want to thank Lawrence Crawford for assisting today in the organ, Mark Strong as media manager, and the individuals who have helped with car parks, lifts, and the tea. We thank Jackie for helping with the tea in the home. And we appreciate that labor of love, and we know it's very much in the hearts and minds of the family that they would want to say thank you in the Lord's name. Now, with these few preliminaries, necessary as they are, we're turning to our order of service. And we're going to sing by way of praise, "I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean." Let's stand together as we worship the Lord with this beautiful hymn. Thank you.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Oh, marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden he prayed, not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. In wonder, angels beheld him and came from the world of light to comfort him in the sorrows he bore for my soul that night. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with the ransomed in glory his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Let's unite together in prayer. Everyone seated. Let's together call on the Lord. Eternal God and loving Heavenly Father, we bow in thy thrice holy presence this afternoon, and we do so in the sweet and adorable name of Jesus Christ. And we plead the merit of the precious blood, and we ask thee through our righteous advocate and the mediator of the new covenant that thou would be mindful of us, merciful to us, and meet with us here. Lord, we need thee. We crave a conscious sense of thy presence. We have come together into the house of mourning. We've come to remember thy sovereignty in death as in life. We've come, Lord, to seek thy word of comfort for our hearts. We're thankful that it is written, comfort ye yourselves with these words. And Lord, we come to give thee thanks for the life and time of the late John Wesley Irvine. We bless thee for the day of his birth. We thank thee for his early years, his life in the farm. We thank you, Lord, for his work as a bus driver with the Ulster Transport Association and later Ulster Bus. We thank you, Lord, for the help in the Martyrs Sunday School and the help here driving the bus. We thank thee today even for his love of gardening. And we rejoice, Lord, in all the many things that we can associate with thy servant. And we rejoice, O God, in the life that he lived. And we rejoice especially in the knowledge that there was a day and time in his life when he was born again of the Holy Spirit and received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And Lord, has left behind a glowing testimony to thy saving and keeping power. And we're very conscious, Lord, on Thursday evening, the Lord Jesus himself came into that hospital room and carried Wesley out of time into thy great eternity. It carried him, Lord, through the gates of glory. Carried him, Lord, home, sweeping through the gates of the New Jerusalem, washed in the blood of the Lamb. And we're thankful that Wesley is now with Christ. His eyes have seen the King. And he's been reunited with loved ones who have died in Christ, even in time past. We pray today again for his sorrowing family. We think of his beloved wife, Rita, here. We think of six children who'll miss the physical and earthly presence of Dad. And we commend them to thee. We think at this time of Sharon and Kyle and Glenn. We ask thee, Lord, that thou will be merciful even to Julianne, Heather and Caroline. We think of grandchildren whose hearts are broken at this hour. And we lift them to thee. We think of Megan. We pray, Lord, for Jonathan. We ask you, Lord, for Matilda. We pray for Timothy. We ask for Anya. And we pray, Lord, for little Ailsa. And we commend them to thy grace. And we pray, Lord, for those who have lost a father-in-law. And we commend David to thee at this time. And we pray you'll remember, Lord, especially Simon. We think of Andrew. And we pray too, Lord, that thou would be pleased even to undertake for the family who have lost a brother. And we commend Lord Muriel to thee. We think of Stanley. We think of Fred and Eileen. And we pray you'll remember, Lord, even the late Brian and Victor. And we ask thee, Lord, that thou will minister to this whole family at this time. Draw near, comfort and help and strengthen them by thy grace. Just remember us now as we wait before thee. We ask thee, Lord, to grant us not only a conscious sense of thy presence. Come with comfort, but come with counsel. And speak a word in season, Lord. And we pray that all that's done, the reading of the scripture, the tribute that's to follow, and the message from thy word, will be owned and blessed of thyself. And as we gather here, help us to remember that the memory of the just is blessed. Bless us now as we wait in thy presence. Help us, undertake for us, and minister to us. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We're going to have our reading of the scriptures, and another member of our church, our treasurer, Mr. William Smith, is going to come and minister to us. Thank you.
I have been humbled indeed to be asked by the family to read this portion of scripture. It has been my privilege to have known Wesley, Rita, and the family as near neighbours for the last 40 years since I moved to Carriduff. Wesley has been a brother and a colleague in the work of God here in Carriduff FPC, but most of all I have known him as a true and loyal friend. There is a friend who sticketh closer than any brother. Do you know that friend today? Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness. For his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Do you thank our treasurer, Mr. William Smith, for this reading of the 23rd Psalm? Now, Wesley was father-in-law to David, Susan, Claire, Simon, and Andrew. And when I first met David, he told me he was the first son-in-law. So the lot has fallen on him to bring a tribute. And we're delighted that he's here with us. And we're going to ask David Wiley now to come and bring this tribute to us. Thank you, David.
Now, can I say it is a tremendous privilege for me to be asked to do this afternoon. And before I say anything, I want to read part of a verse and just lift five words out of it from Luke chapter 23. And here's what it says. Luke chapter 23 and verse 50. And it says, "Behold, there was a man named Joseph, and he was a good man." I want to use those five words. He was a good man. And that really summarizes all that I'm going to say in the next few minutes. My father-in-law, he was a good man. Before I pay a tribute to my dear father-in-law, I think it's only fitting that I pay a tribute to his family, to four daughters, my wife Sharon, the eldest, Heather, Caroline, Julianne, two sons, Kyle and Glenn, for their care for their father over the last number of weeks, and for their support for their mother. It was mostly exemplary. And so I just want all the congregation to know today that this family have been more than good with their father and for their father and their mother, really since Christmas time and before it. As Mr. McLaughlin has said, I'm the first son-in-law. I first met Wesley Irvine in about September or October time in the year 2000. He became my father-in-law in September 2001. And since then, I have found him to be a quiet, sincere, caring, contented, consistent Christian gentleman. He was a good man. Never once in all those years did I ever hear him raise his voice. Never once. Never once in over 20 years have I seen him angry. Never once. He was a good man. I want to hinge what I say on maybe five points. Firstly, his devotion. His devotion. He was a devoted, dedicated man. Devoted first and foremost to his family. To his wife, to my mother-in-law, Rita, and to the six of them. He has been devoted for all those years. And I can say personally also that he was devoted to his in-laws as well. I have no doubt about that. I saw that on display many times. He was devoted to his grandchildren. A man with a heart for children, maybe especially younger children. We're talking about a man here today who was devoted. Devoted to his family, devoted to his church. A faithful member of the Martyrs' Memorial on the Raven Hill Road for many, many years. And as we have heard already, a foundation member of the congregation here meeting in Carriduff since the year 1996. Devoted to this place as well. And was here while he was able to be here. He was a devoted man. To his family, to his church family. He was devoted to his Savior. That's the big thing. And everything else just stemmed from that. There's a man we're burying today, and he was devoted to his Lord and Savior. The one that loved him. The one who died for him. The one who he trusted a lifetime ago. And the one that he served for all these years. In his own quiet way, he was devoted to him too. And that carried right through until the very end. Sharon and I sat with him in the Ulster Hospital on Wednesday night. Things were very far from good. He was slowly slipping away at that stage. Sharon asked me if I would read for him several verses, which I did from John chapter 10. I read a verse, verse 11, that says this, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. And as I read those words, there was something touched his soul. He couldn't speak, but Sharon and I were both very aware that here's a man, and he's devoted to his Lord and Savior. His devotion, his diligence, his hard work. This is a man who worked hard. Moving from County Fermanagh in 1965 to live in the Carriduff area, to become a bus driver. And right through until 1998, working as a bus driver, and at the same time, doing some part-time farming. A diligent, hard-working man. Retirement would have come, retiring age at least came in 1998. 65 years old. But that wasn't retirement for my dear father, no, I can assure you. Because once he stopped the buses, he started his gardening work, cutting grass and cutting hedges and cutting trees round Carriduff and Newton Breda and likely as far away as Saintfield. And he never stopped. And as a result of those 20-odd years of gardening work, he really got to know the whole countryside. And he left his mark on many, a very positive mark. In fact, he was described in the house the other night as a legend in the area, and that's maybe no bad description. 51 years in the one house, a foundation member of the development they live in. And so he's been around these parts for a lifetime, working, working hard, working long hours. He was a diligent man. Not only was he a devoted man, not only was he a diligent man, he was a very determined man. And those who know him best will be well aware of that. Working long past when he was able to be working. And in the last few years, he started taking Kyle with him to help him. But determined, not one to lie down, not one to give up, one to keep going for as long as he possibly could. He was a determined man. And I just heard in the house again the other day that he was cutting grass, other people's grass, right up until last summer. 87 years of age. He was a determined man. Up trees, cutting branches when they shouldn't have been. Cutting hedges that were much higher than him without any help. He did all those things. He kept going. Even though Rita told him not to do it, or he wasn't able, or the family did, it didn't work. He was a determined man. In his work, in his walking, this man liked to walk. And William, who has just read from Psalm 23 for us, he and Wesley would have walked these roads every Sunday afternoon for years. And maybe other times as well. The last few months, that became increasingly difficult. And he wasn't able. But he thought he was. And he still tried to walk, even when he really shouldn't have been out. In fact, Sharon, my wife, rang me one day, maybe 2-3 months ago. And she was down the street with her father. And he was on his rollator. See, he was used walking. And he wasn't going to stop walking. And even if it meant going out with help, he still did it for as long as he could. He was a man with determination. A man of devotion. A man of diligence, a man of determination. Sadly, he's a man who started to decline. This is when it became painful. This is when we realized that my father-in-law was no longer the man he was whenever he became my father-in-law. It was all very different now. The last 3 or 4 months in particular became increasingly difficult. Heart conditions, other weaknesses, other ailments set in, and dear Wesley Irvine started to decline. And we knew that, even though maybe we didn't want to admit it, we knew that he would likely never be better again. Since Christmas, time has been tough. Spell in the Royal Hospital at the end of January, into February. Back home again. And really never well after that. And then the last 3 weeks in particular became increasingly difficult. As he was taken into the Ulster Hospital 3 weeks ago on Thursday night passed, the situation wasn't good. As those 3 weeks went on, his condition deteriorated. He was going down. Until my wife Sharon got a phone call from the consultant last Monday afternoon. And she was told that this is not good. And the first few days of last week became increasingly difficult. As the family took turns to sit with him round the clock, it got worse and worse. I last saw him on Wednesday evening. He hadn't too many hours left then. He was quickly declining, quickly going down. Heather sat on Wednesday night. She was there again on Thursday. And she phoned all the family around 5:30 to say, you need to get to the hospital quick. Now, somewhere a distance away, it was rush hour time, and there was no quick way to get to Dundonald at 5:30 at night. And not only did I want to think about his decline, but I want to finish by thinking about his departure. His departure, his death. He had suffered much. He had suffered long. He could suffer no more. Nor could the family watch him suffer anymore. And about 6:15 on Thursday night, in Ward 16 in the Ulster Hospital, he departed the Ulster Hospital. He departed this world, and he went straight to heaven. Philippians chapter 1 tells us this, to depart, and to be with Christ, which is far better. Wesley had a good life. My father-in-law had a good life. I had many good times with him. But something happened on Thursday evening that was better than them all by far. When he left a body of weakness and frailty and weariness, and he went straight to heaven. What a wonder. What a joy. What a thought. Depart and to be with Christ. He was a good man. A husband, a father, a father-in-law, a grandfather, a brother, a member of this church congregation, a man with an outstanding Christian testimony in this area. He was a good man. Thank you.
We do thank David for this very, very fitting testimony. Lovely words. Speaking of his father-in-law, I want to just read a portion of scripture and share a few thoughts as we come to the conclusion of our service. In Isaiah 43, we read these words, "But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee, have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. When thou passest through the waters, I'll be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, they shall not be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Saviour. I give Egypt for thy ransom, Ethiopia and Seba for thee. Since thou wast precious in my sight, thou hast been honourable. And I have loved thee. Therefore will I give men for thee and people for thy life. Fear not, for I am with thee. I will bring thy seed from the east and gather thee from the west. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from far and my daughters from the end of the earth. Every one that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. I have formed him. Yea, I have made him. This afternoon, as we conclude the service, I want to set before you Isaiah 43, verses 1 to 7 that I've read to you. And I want to entitle this little message, The Wonder of God's Relationship. The last Thursday morning, I read these words to the late Wesley Irvine. He was conscious, he was responsive. And I read to him, believing that these words would bring him real comfort and help. Now, little did I know that this would be the final passage that I would ever read to him in his earthly pilgrimage. Now, these seven verses are all about the wonder of relationship, God's relationship to ancient Israel. You see, God could say to ancient Israel five things. He could say this, I have created you for my glory. I have formed you. Yea, I have made you. He could add something else, I have loved you. He could add more, I have redeemed you. And then the fourth thing he said, I have called thee by thy name, thou art mine. And the fifth precious thought was this, fear not, for I am with thee. I took up those words and I applied them to Brother Wesley. Glenn was with me and we had a little time. And I believe those words brought real comfort and strength to Wesley, even in his final hours. And I thought about the service. I don't normally do this, but I felt this would be fitting just to leave with the congregation this morning. Conscious that we need comfort. Conscious that there's a grieving family. Conscious that others need counsel. So a few little thoughts. Think first of all of the wonder of God's plan. It says in verse 7 in this lovely text, For I have created him for my glory. I have formed him. Yea, I have made him. You see, Wesley Irvine knew and believed that God had made him for his glory, that God had made him in his image. Wesley knew and believed that his very existence on planet Earth, his lifespan, was totally dependent on the Lord. He was not here by chance. He was not here by accident. He was part of God's amazing plan. And his birthday was at the beginning of that amazing plan. You see, Wesley didn't believe in the Big Bang theory. He didn't believe that mankind evolved from some kind of ape. He didn't believe that we emerged from some sort of chemical slime pool or soup. Wesley could testify, as he often did, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. He knew the Lord as creator and maker. He knew that the Lord was the very source of his existence. He knew the Lord was also sustainer and provider, because it says in Acts 17 and 28, in him we move and live and are being. And Wesley knew it was the Lord who gives us breath to breathe and strength and health to enjoy. It's the Lord who provides for us on the journey. And one of his prayers in the prayer meeting here was this, he daily loadeth me with benefits, and he give thanks to the Lord. Ask yourself, why are you alive on planet Earth? Why did you have the birthday that you have? There's a simple answer. There's a sublime answer, and it's this, God made you. Man's chief end, therefore, is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. You see, the issues of life are of him. And with him, you see, God has a plan. The journey of life for you begins with your birthday. And physically, it ends with the day of your death. And even the issues of death are with him. Because it's he who determines the times and appoints the bounds of our habitation. And on the journey, it's your duty and responsibility to know God as creator and maker, sustainer and provider, to know him as Lord and Redeemer, to know him as Judge. Oh, that we could come to realize that all of us, preacher included, are totally dependent on him. And you're totally accountable to him, because the book says then every one of us shall give an account of himself to the Lord. God's amazing plan. Think secondly, the wonder of God's privilege. Listen to what it says in verse 4, and I have loved thee. Now, isn't that amazing? Is that not mind-blowing? The Lord isn't asking, what do you love? Now, we all have loves in our life. We've heard Wesley, indeed, loved his family, his home comforts. He loved his children. He loved being growing up on a farm. He loved being a bus driver for the Ulster Transport Association, then Ulster Bus. He loved having good friends. Of course, he didn't suffer fools gladly. He loved the Sunday school excursions, driving the big double-decker out of the Martyrs Memorial with the bus full. He drove the children here and carried off Sunday school and Sunday school excursions to Bangor. He loved being a member of the Loyal Orange Institution, the Royal Black Preceptory. He was proud of that. But the Lord didn't say, what do you love? He didn't even say, do you love me here in this text? We know that the Lord asked Peter 3 times that question, lovest thou me? But what is it that the Lord's saying? The wonder of God's privilege. I have loved you. Why? He says in Deuteronomy 7 and 8, I have loved you because I loved you. No reason. Chose to love. What way did he love us? Let me explain. He loved us eternally. You see, the Bible says, I've loved you with an everlasting love. Eons and eons in eternity past, in the council chambers of God's eternity, in the triune relationship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the triune God set his electing love upon those in Christ. He said he loves you freely. Hosea 4:4, I will love them freely without money and without price. You see, this love was rooted in the free, sovereign grace of God. He loved them sacrificially. Galatians 2:20, the Son of God loved me and gave himself for me, Paul says. Can you not stand at the cross? Could you discover an amazing truth? But God commended his love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Not introduced us merely to it, but commended us to us. He's rich in love. It's a great love. He loved us personally. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You take the word world out and put your own name in. For God so loved. Wesley could say, for God so loved Wesley Irvine, that he gave his only begotten Son, that if Wesley Irvine believes in him, Wesley Irvine should not perish but have everlasting life. Not only eternally, freely and sacrificially and personally, but loves us continually. It says in John 13:1, having loved his own, he loved them right unto the end. See, Wesley discovered this amazing truth that God could come to him and say, not just I've made you, Wesley, for myself. I've had a plan for you in the journey, but I've loved you. Here's why, here's the way. Wesley came to realize this wonderful news. It filled his heart. The simple truth, Jesus loves me, blessed his soul. What about the wonder of God's price? I have redeemed thee. Isaiah 43:1. Does that not bring us to Calvary? The place of the blood of the Lamb. See, the Apostle Paul says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. And Wesley Irvine, in the journey of life, discovered he was a sinner. He'd broken God's law, a guilty, hell-deserving sinner. He learned how sin came into the perfect world. Romans 5:12, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world and death by sin, and death passed upon all men for all have sinned. He knew for all have sinned, come short of the glory of God, included him. Even though God had made him and he was an image bearer of God, he knew he was a fallen, sinful creature. And he knew that he'd sinned against the Lord. He knew that he'd gotten a mortal soul. And he knew that the soul was the most precious thing that he had. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Wesley knew that he needed to be saved. Saved from sin's penalty, power, pleasure, one day from its presence. Wesley discovered there was only one savior of sinners, the Lord Jesus Christ. Not the church that saves, it's Christ. It's not baptism that washes away sin, it's the blood. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus, the blood of Calvary's Lamb. And Wesley knew if he died in his sins, he would be lost and end up in that awful place called hell for all eternity. There was a time when he came under conviction of sin. I believe it was under the ministry of Leonard Ravenhill about Fermanagh many, many years ago. He repented of that sin. He received Christ. The Bible says, but as many as received him, to them give he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe in his name. And you know one of his favorite hymns? It's in our hymn book. He quoted it often in the prayer meeting. Let me just quote a few verses. Not all the blood of beasts and Jewish altars slain could give the guilty conscience peace or wash away the stain. But Christ, the heavenly Lamb, takes all our sins away. A sacrifice of nobler name, a richer blood than they. My faith would lay her hand on that dear head of thine when like a penitent I stand and there confess my sin. Now, is that your testimony this afternoon? Can you say, by way of thanksgiving, because the Lord says to you, I have redeemed you? Has the Lord come and said, not only do I love you, but I've redeemed you? The blood has been applied. Remember, he said, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Not only the wonder of God's plan, and you've got the wonder here of God's privilege and the wonder of God's praise, but you've got the wonder of God's plea. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. That's the effectual call of God in the gospel. God calls to men to repent and believe the gospel, to come to him for rest, to come and receive Christ as Lord and Savior. See, Wesley could say, now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me, not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. I am his. But God comes to Wesley and says to Wesley, not only I belong to you, but you belong to me, Wesley. You're mine. Mine because you're born of the Spirit. Mine because of blood. Mine because of the love of God in Christ. There was a time when Wesley heard that call to come. The Bible says, come now. Behold, now is the accepted time. Now is the day of salvation. It says, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for no man knoweth what a day may bring forth. Tomorrow may be too late. But think of this as we finish. You've got the wonder of God's promise. You see, because Wesley realized God has made me for himself and I'm part of his plan, and I've got this wonderful privilege that God has said, I have loved you, Wesley Irvine, from eternity, freely, sacrificially, personally, and love you continually. I love you now at this moment, even in your weakness and in your bodily state in the hospital. And I've paid a wonderful price for you. I've redeemed you by the precious blood. And there was a time when I called you to myself, and you came as you were a guilty sinner, and you repented, and you received my son. And Wesley, here's my testimony of you. You're my child, Wesley. And here's my promise. Fear not, for I am with you. Do you know there's 365 fear nots in the Bible? One for each day of the year. Listen to these words as we finish. When thou passest through the waters, I'll be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. When you're facing rivers of difficulty, whether it's a tsunami-like situation or whether it's a raging inferno, and you're full of fear and alarm and dread, and you're in great distress, and how many people in the congregation could be facing a river of difficulty right now? Do you hear God's promise? Do you know the reality of it? Because here's life's greatest blessing. Fear not, for I am with thee. We heard a reading from Psalm 23. What's the verse 4? Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? For thou art with me. Even in the river of death, Wesley wasn't abandoned. When he treaded the very verge of Jordan, which is the symbol of death, the Lord was with him, because the Lord never abandons his people. There'll not be one of his children left behind. We sing the little children's chorus, away far beyond Jordan we'll meet in that land. Oh, won't it be grand? Shake hands. If you get there before I do, look out for me, for I'm coming to you. And in a childlike way, Wesley had this wonderful promise ringing in his ears. Let go of your fear, Wesley. Rivers of difficulty, I've been with you.
But now you're facing the greatest difficulty of all, the river of death. Have courage. Don't be afraid. Because here's your comfort. I'm with you as the companion. You know, I love the little story of footprints. Walking along the sand, two walking together in agreement and union, having communion. And then all of a sudden, there's only one set. And the pilgrim saying, Lord, why did you leave me? And what does the Lord say? I didn't leave you, child. I was carrying you. You see, these words were the words that I left with Wesley. And I leave them with you as a congregation at this time. And I leave them with you for you to think about. Do you realize that God has made you in his image? Do you realize that God loves you in Christ, and proof is the cross, the blood shedding? Do you realize that God paid a tremendous price for your redemption? And yet some are trampling underfoot that great price. And God makes a plea to all. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And if he calls and you come, then he gives you the promise, you're mine for time and eternity. And you have this great promise. Fear not, for I am with thee. Whatever you face, you don't have to be afraid. You can let go of your fear because you've got me by your side. Do you fear death? Do you fear the judgment? Are you concerned and troubled about your sin? Do you fear God's eternity? You ought to if you're out of Christ. And we urge you, you've heard about his departure from David. Paul could say, for me to live is Christ. And Wesley was a Christ-centered man. And he added this, Paul did, Philippians 1:21, and to die is gain. Wesley's death meant an entrance to heaven, absent from the body, present with the Lord. I just asked as we finish, have you that assurance? Can you say amen to that at this time? We're going to close the service. We'll sing the hymn. After the singing of the hymn, we'll have prayer. We'd ask that you'd remain standing as the coffin is taken from the church. We'd asked as well that as the family makes their way to the door, that if you're not staying for tea and refreshments, and there is tea and refreshments for all, and want to speak to the family, then you can do so as they have vacated the church building out in the car park. We'll be going off now shortly to Ballycairn Presbyterian Church Graveyard. You're invited to come and join with us. And you're invited then to come back for refreshments after the committal. But if you would like refreshments, if you're not coming to the graveside, then please feel free to go into the Luther Hall and have some refreshments. You'll notice there, and I'm sure the family will not mind me emphasizing, that if donations, if desired, to Ward 16 of the Ulster Hospital and our own church, and you can forward donations to Mr. Norman McBriar. We're going to sing in closing. I'm pressing on the upward way. This was an old favourite of Wesley's, and we'll sing before we have prayer and the benediction. Stand as we sing. Thank you.
let's close in prayer with a benediction. Merciful God, we thank thee for the conscious sense of thy presence. We bless thee for the help given, especially to a sorrowing family. We pray you'll continue to speak that word of comfort to their hearts about their loved one. We rejoice in the knowledge that for the late Wesley Irvine, it's absent from the body and present with the Lord. And we thank you for this tremendous tribute that his son-in-law has played to him, that he was a good man. And we thank thee, O God, even in his final hours, he could look to the bleeding Lamb of Calvary and find comfort to know that soon the Savior would carry him home. And we pray you'll take these few words about this wondrous relationship from Isaiah and you'll apply it to the hearts of all who heard it. Lord, we ask thee that you'll help us to realize that you've made us in your image, that you've loved us in the way that you have and why. Help us to understand we've been redeemed by the blood. And help us to know, Lord, that call, even to repent and believe the gospel. And help us to receive this promise to our hearts. Fear not, for I am with thee. Thou dost know the many that are fearful in the rivers of difficulty, the many that have trepidation even in the hour of death. Oh God, we pray you'll come and apply your word in a comforting way. We ask thee to remember dear Rita now. We think of her 6 children. We ask you, Lord, for the 5 in-laws. We commend to thee, Lord, Wesley's family, those that are still alive. We ask thee, Lord, to remember Tilly here and members of her family belonging to Rita's side. And we commend them to thy grace. And we pray that as we take our way now to the Ballykern graveyard, that you'll give us traveling mercies, that we'll know the help of God. And even there, Lord, as we have the committal service, that the blessing of the Lord will linger with us. We thank you for the tea provided. We pray you'll bless it to all who eat and drink. And we pray now that as we take our leave from the house of God, that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of thyself and the communion of the Holy Spirit will be upon us, both now and evermore. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Just remain standing, please, while the coffin is taken from the church.